Very nice. So we start the first video. Just a moment.
Hi there, my name is Trevor.
I think there is a problem with the sound. I can't hear.
With Mondragon University.
Okay, okay, then I restarted, sorry.
My name is Trevor Schultz, and I would like to give you a little bit of background on this course that the Platform Co-op Consortium in New York at the New School is teaching with Mondragon University in the Basque Country. The course started about a year ago, or more than a year ago, when the colleagues from Mondragon came to the New School in New York City, and we decided to work together. Just a few days later, the pandemic started, and we decided to put on an emergency course that would respond to this crisis by offering people an opportunity to learn about platform cooperatives and to work with local partners to incubate their projects. So this has been the history. So there have been two courses so far. This is the third edition. We taught about 850 students from 47 countries. And we are really looking forward to working with you starting early in September. So the course officially starts on August 30th, but we will start shortly thereafter. The course essentially in the first month gives you some general introduction to the topic, gives you an understanding of what platform cooperatives are, how they are scaled, in which sectors they emerge, where you can find funding, you know, some discussion of ownership and much more. So the big questions that people have been asking us over the past years. And after that, after the first months, we will split the course into where researchers and policymakers, people who don't really want to incubate projects, will work with me. And what we will do is we will create our own syllabus. So I want to work with you and respond to your needs on the fly. Out of your discussion, out of our discussion, we will formulate a syllabus that will that we will run then for the last 2 months of this course, and really responding to what you are interested in. Right. So this will be led in English, and parallel to that, we have a track for practitioners, which will be led by Mondragon in collaboration with our local partners, so in your local languages, and the course tries to bring together both of these tracks. In parallel, I will be teaching a course for graduate students at Harvard University, which will focus on data cooperatives, and the 12 participants in that course will also inform our course. So they will present to us and you can ask questions and maybe even get them involved in your projects. In November, we also have the annual PCC conference, which will take place in Berlin this year. And there you will be able to follow the digital track, of course, online and perhaps participate in it as well. And of course, follow all the sessions. So that is from November 12th to 18th. So I think that's it in a nutshell. We will give you more information as it develops. I hope you will consider joining. We really look forward to working with you. I think participants in previous classes have really enjoyed, particularly meeting the other researchers and practitioners to find the others, find people who work on similar topics, have similar needs and exchange notes. So I think that's the opportunity. I will keep it short and look forward to meeting you towards the end of August.
Thank you. The sound would had a bit of echo, but I hope you were able to hear properly. Good. Then thank you for sharing. We have now Jose Mari. Maybe you can tell us more about the topic and explain us a bit more about the course, because there were some questions already in the chat.
Hello, everyone. So happy to be here. So first of all, thank you, Estefania, and the whole team behind for organizing the session. It's a pleasure for me on behalf of Mondragon, and in this case, as Trevor cannot be in person, also on behalf of the new school, to be sharing with you a little bit what we are hands-on with the digital platform COOPS, and actually what we have learned over the last mainly 2 years, with 1 year and a half, 18 months, with this platform COOPS Now program as a whole. I'm seeing already that you have a few questions linked to a little bit. Okay, let's talk about a few of the cases that you were sharing before. Estefania was already mentioning a few cases that is there. Maybe what I would love to share with you is a little bit on behalf of our experience in Mondragon, how do we envision this new reality of cooperativism? Okay, so the reality that we observe is that there might be few ingredients taking place in the sense of the role of cooperativism as a way of serving humanity, okay? As you know, the heritage of the cooperative movement is very long, but for some reasons, in many cases, has been with a deep value, social impact, local communities way of serving, but at the same time, not combining the business excellence and the impact that might be generating that. Okay, so I believe that digital platform COOPS is in one way one of the new alternatives to really rebirth the original purpose of the cooperative movement, updating to the world in a global economy, as well updating in a way of a gig economy in that sense. No? Our experience from Mondragon has been a little like this. As you know, maybe I don't know, I have a presentation that maybe you would love to, I could share a few insights here that might be helping to you. I don't want the session today to be based on like giving a talk on a long presentation, but maybe yes, few facts that might help us to really understand a little bit when I talk about what is Mondragon, maybe Estefania, you were addressing there, what are some of the ingredients that we can have. Mondragon, we are a cooperative experience. We share the same principles for the cooperative movement as a whole. And although we were starting 70 years ago in a small region in the Basque country, we accept fully the cooperative principles that they are similar to the global international cooperative alliance principles. Maybe a few of the characteristics that we have different is that all our cooperatives, they are worker cooperatives. So in that sense, we combine multi-stakeholders cooperatives that are always cooperating our working capacity. So for example, we have a retail, similarly to maybe what you have in Germany, what could be a Deka in the past, but in our case it's a consumer cooperative, but always a worker cooperative. Why Mondragon might be remarkable? I think one aspect is because of the size, okay? So we have been able to really create 100,000 workers who are part of the Mondragon ecosystem somehow, with 250 companies and over 98 cooperatives. Okay, so I think one aspect is the size, that maybe for us this is one element. Second element is, although we are still being based in Mondragon and in Spain as legal entities cooperatives, we have been operating companies and factories in this case all around the world. Okay, so we are exposed internationally, although we haven't found yet the way to really create cooperatives abroad. Now we have the very first exceptions there. We are just registered a cooperative in Berlin. We have another cooperative registered in Seoul, in Korea, in South Korea, but this might be the exception. Okay. Regarding entrepreneurship, maybe you have here the elements that makes unique of the model of Mondragon. That might be one of the links when we are talking today of digital platform COOPS and how to nurture entrepreneurship on digital platform COOPS, how this brings. No? Here you have some of the elements that has made the success of our experience in Mondragon, but maybe here I would just willing to point out a few of them. We never play alone what we can do together. So in this case, our principle of intercooperation in everything we do, form an intercooperation structures. also our capacity of creating jobs and creating companies. Here you see the evolution of job creations of Mondragon since the very beginning, 1950s, very small until today. In the last 10 years, we have reduced from over 100,000 employees or workers, workforce, to a little bit less. Now we are in 83,000. So also we grow and come back, but always we have very strong commitment on the capacity of creating jobs. And also here, maybe now that we see in the world a lot of fragmentation in between countries, nationalism, each country to defend better, just closing themselves. What we have learned in Mondragon is that we become stronger when we grow abroad. Is it possible to create jobs abroad and jobs at home in that way? Okay, so those cooperatives who open factories abroad, they grow abroad and also they grow at home. So more than talking about the delocation strategy, we can be talking a multi-localization strategy. No, it's a win-win. You create wealth abroad and you create wealth at home. Okay, so maybe these are some of the ingredients of Mondragon, but then here maybe I'll leave you for later our strategy for supporting the entrepreneurship program. Few things that we have realized and learned over the years. One, 13 years ago, we realized that although we have been powerful in the past, we were disconnected to our creating capacity, our capacity of rebirth. And I think in this republic, re-understanding on the way we can actually nurture the creation of new cooperatives. So we open up a new strategy. I was happy to be one of the co-founders of Mondragon Team Academy, a new education revolution to really put at the center youth and education as the light of the society and transform young students into team entrepreneurs who create new cooperatives. I don't want to go slow in this today. If those of you would like to go deeper, later on we can talk on this, but here you see some of the elements on how we do this, you know, how do we really nurture education. I think on that, Estefania, you are quite expert on the way we do things, as you have been supporting us in Berlin with the new initiative that we are opening there. And also what you are doing with Bloom now with the new project, as well with these Republic talks, I think is part of the way we learn. What makes this outstanding is from this new way of learning, 97% of those people who graduate are working and are working on something they call a dream job. For us, this is very important. So is it possible to learn in a different way? And then in a moment of a struggle of youth employability in Europe and abroad, then there is an answer for that. And this was for us like a blind spot that we have in Mondragon. And in the last 13 years, we have rebirth. Second blind spot is the platform, digital platforms. So Mondragon has been very strong industry-wise in the past, but digitally-wise, we have not been able to really tackle the gig economy as a whole. No? So I think in that sense, we have few experiments. We have few examples that were successful. We have a lot of technology inside our existing cooperatives. Meaning, I don't know, in the automotive sector, we have a lot of technology in place. In the retail sector, we also have a lot of technology in place for all the logistics. But as a whole, we were not able to really address the creation of businesses in this new gig economy. Okay, so maybe because of this, and especially because of the way we were observing the change in the society, we challenge ourselves to really nurture a transformation. Here, maybe you are seeing some of the media articles from Spain. But what we're observing over the last 10 years is that there is this new digital monopolies, players who are actually conquering the world and they are not moving into a serving way of service. So there's a digital transformation taking place, but it's a digital transformation against humanity. So in our sense, it's not in favor of humanity and local communities, but against them. No? I think maybe as part of the program we'll be there. How is it possible that Uber is still losing money while has been spread all around the world? The reason behind is that Uber is aiming to colonize the world. You know, it's not aiming to really being a successful business model, but actually what they look for is to be the only alternative, the biggest one, conquering the world. Similarly, we see with other platforms as Facebook or Amazon, they're actually trying to conquer the reality that. Recently, a lot with the pandemic speed up a lot. Also, the riders reality. I think also you are suffering it in Germany. In Spain, we have few examples of very successful new digital platforms that they are developing. Recently, if you are interested, there's an article from the University of Barcelona that proves that the business model of Globo, it's our local Justit company, is not sustainable unless they have very high commissions, over 30, 40% commissions for the restaurants. and unprivileged conditions for the writers. Okay, so in that sense, it's okay. We conquer the digital economy, but with alternatives that they are not sustainable, neither for the people who work there, neither for the local communities that might be there. So with this, and with a very humble approach, we tied up with Trevor and the work that he has been doing from New School and the Platform Cooperatives Consortium until maybe 2 years ago, mainly more theoretically, to really connect with how we can nurture a new transformation on the possibilities of creating digital platform co-ops. Okay, so as Trevor was mentioning, we opened up the course last February 2020, a course that for me, to be honest, it was in the midst of the pandemic, we are in need of solutions. And we said, come on, these digital platform co-ops might be an alternative to what the world is going. But to be honest, we could not expect the number of participants who eventually were willing to participate since the very beginning. If we talk about conventional cooperative programs, if we open a program from Mondragon, probably there will be very few, 50 people, 60 people interested globally. And then when we open up a program on digital platform cooperatives, then we are having in the first 2 weeks more than 1,000 from more than 50 countries willing to take part and to participate in this program. No? So for us, also the program was a COVID program, so totally accessible. You get a certificate by New School and Mondragon for $100 or $150 for economically developed countries, and for the Global South in general was more $50. But for us, what was fascinating is that there is a aim and a need of alternatives to the gig economy, conventional gig economy, all around the world. Okay, what we have learned in these 18 months is that we have 828 participants in this 3 months program, first and second edition. Around 300 projects of new startups, digital platform co-ops have been created. We were, since the very beginning, willing to do this as a global program, but running with local partners. And we have 49 local partners representing 55 countries to really take care of the way to accompany these new startups on digital platform co-ops. And has been like somehow quite a fascinating journey. No? As Trevor was saying in his video, we are opening now at the end of August. Now is the enrollment open. September will be opening up the third edition of this program with the aim of keep on cultivating this awareness of what is digital platform co-ops, as well as nurturing the creation of new startups. Okay. Something also that we have learned is that it's not enough just to seed new projects, but also what we need is to accelerate. So last year, we ran in a program with the Climate Kick. We ran the first platform co-op accelerator in Europe. We're having 188 candidates, and we have accelerated 10 platform cooperatives. From there, 6 of them, they were in a prototype stage. So also you may see that the reality of the digital platform co-ops movement is still very, I would say, weak or emerging. And then there were 4 of them, including Airbnb and some of the cases, who were ready to scale their impact. And these days we are registering in Mondragon, they are in the Basque Country, we are registering 7, our first platform, digital platform co-ops. So also, as I mentioned before, we didn't have much on digital platform. Now with this, we are cutting. I would love to maybe finish with this. No? When we are talking about digital platform co-ops, what could be some of the examples that might help us here? No? So what for us is interesting to see here, we have put 5 fields. The field of tourists, creating alternatives to Airbnb and Booking, already exists the model of Airbnb. I don't know if you are familiar or not with it. Later on, if you want, we can comment. But we believe that it's an alternative to a pure digital tourist sector, but really addressing that is not something for the local governments to reject Airbnb and to control Airbnb, but to be in favor of digital platforms that will be serving a proper development of tourism. Similarly, I think we have faced the problem of the taxi drivers all around the world. How does the local town halls fight against Uber as a whole and Cabify? Today, we have a bunch of around quite few initiatives that they are interesting from the digital platform co-ops field, as IBA.co. IBA.co, for example, what I love about them is originally from Canada, is that technology-wise, they use blockchain to the full. And they are, we could say even they might be technology-wise even more powerful than Uber. Probably not because of the size of Uber, but yes, technology cutting edge while developing a new digital platform co-op. Another great example that started just a few months ago by an ex-Uber as one of the general managers is the case of drivers.coop in New York as creating an alternative to Uber and Lyft in New York. And so far they are already having more than 33,000 drivers, taxi drivers in New York and more than 300,000 rides. Okay, so it gives us hope that although there might be already quite monopoly sectors, is it possible to create an alternative? For sure, the pandemic has also speeded up the needs of health assistance. And on that, we have also some interesting examples. Here we put maybe the case of Witchwork, that is traditional cooperative of nurses in the Netherlands. Although I think digitally wise, they are developing how could be the model there. Similarly, we have Suara in Catalonia, in Spain. They are also exploring how to develop strategically the way of having these residents and assistants, health assistants through a digital platform COPS. They have a powerful project to present for the next generation, European next generation funds. And also in the case of the Basque Country, we also have the case of GSR, that is the case of the Mondragon. For example, this is good, no? Mondragon has GSR, it's one of the fast growing cooperatives in Mondragon. It's about running residences, elderly people residence, but until now we didn't have a clear digital platform strategy. And now we are nurturing how really to transform the business model to embrace fully all the potential of the digital platforms. Fourth, and probably now one of the most exciting digital platform sector is the data co-ops, so data cooperatives. Actually, in November, we will be having a conference on digital platforms in Berlin, hosted by Humboldt University. And in that conference, Humboldt is really saying, okay, we need to really devote into data cooperatives. Also from MIT, some reliable, I would say, reference, as is the case of Petland. He's traditionally, he has been not in someone supporting the cooperative movement, but now he's one of the ones who defends and proposes data cooperatives as a reasonable alternative to the existing data gig economy development and how it's developing. If we talk about the specific examples, here you have three, Polypoly. I love them from Berlin. Those of you who are from there, I think you might be familiar with them. I think they are doing an amazing work. And then two similar models, that is the case of MyData or MiData from Switzerland and Saluscope from Catalonia. MiData and Saluscope, both of them, they do the same. It's about data, health, and patients' data that they are taking care of through a digital platform. And in the case of Polypoly, it's about any sort of data that you can be independent. I put also here the example of Fermondo, because also led by Felix from Germany, might be the first digital platform co-op. So if we would say, where was the very beginning? Probably Fermondo was the first digital platform co-op, and they have this bold dream to really create an alternative to Amazon. Okay, so still Fermondo is operating mainly in Germany, and in terms of size, I do not know which is the real alternative that they represent, but in the way of management, they are taking care of a business model similarly to Amazon, but using a full cooperative democratic control. Okay, so these more than the 2,000 sellers in the platform, they are taking decisions together. Also the users are not just customers, but they are also users and co-op members who can bring their voice in the decisions that the digital platform needs to take. So although in terms of size is still small comparing with the other ones, I do believe that it's a very interesting model to explore. And also Felix now, for example, is addressing or bringing the importance of developing a very strong digital backbone. The last company he has created is also a company to support the digital platform cooperative movement technologically wise, similarly to other partners, as is the case of Factic in Argentina, who are also trying to support the digital backbone of the digital platform cooperative movement. And finally, is the case of the riders, food delivery, that in the pandemic has speeded up a lot. Only in Spain, we are talking about more than 50,000 jobs, okay? Only Glovo has more than 16,000 riders. So in that sense, when we look at new niche fields of job creation, maybe this could be one of those. But then what, from our side, what we cannot accept is that this will be underemployment conditions for these new sectors. Okay, so the digital platform COOPS tries to create an alternative to take care of these new job creation places, but with a model that is in favor of the conditions, in this case of the labor, in this case of the riders. No? And maybe the example I bring you here is CoopCycle. CoopCycle is a very tiny cooperative, also right, but technologically wise, maybe not so sophisticated, but what is great is that already more than 100 replicants all around the world are using CoopCycle, a small technology package and model, in order to develop an alternative food delivery unit or entity in the local communities. Okay. I don't know if this, sorry if I went too far, but in order to give us some insights about what is Mondragon, what is Platform COOPS, what have we been learned, maybe this could help us to bring this. And I don't know if from there we can move into Q&A questions or things like maybe that you already have shared. I don't know if Estefania, you will help me with the questions there, and then we can.
Yes, I've been collecting some questions also from myself. It was perfect timing, Jose Mari, thank you. It was very informative. And so first question, can you, I will read on the chat, that's from Carl. You can also ask yourself if you want, otherwise I'm reading it. Is the IOTA Foundation and the things, and the thing industry something useful for the data co-ops? IOTA.org. So probably you know, Jose Mari, you're mute now.
So I don't know exactly in this sense, in the terms of the IOTA and the IOTA Foundation exactly, but for sure I know the how is that. One of the things that I love about the digital platform movement, I think it is the fact of really embracing fully the open source philosophy. So in that sense, the whole model that is behind is really not only to create an alternative in favor of the people, but also as much as we can to really use open source in everything that we do. Okay, so in that case, for example, this IOTA Foundation, for sure, they might be creating, okay, which is the IoT backbone collectively for everyone in an open source model instead of just a proprietary model, or maybe we can see the same in the crypto development field. What the digital platform COOPS as a movement is, we are fully in favor of open source. Does this mean that all the digital platform COOPS are using open source? No, okay? Because in some cases, as you may know, I don't know how many of you are programmers, but developing open source full solutions at a certain level requests much more strong development of the solution and much more time and much more dedication. And in some cases, in order to run an alternative, you need to do it more using more proprietary solutions. But as a philosophical principle, yes, the digital platform groups is in favor of the use of the open source in everything we do. In this case, concrete of the IOTA Foundation, I don't know how they are playing specifically, so sorry for that. But in general, what I will say is this is the philosophy. I mentioned before the example of Factic, for example, in Argentina, they are, I think, the ones who are the ambassadors of the open source philosophy. If we look at Spain, we have examples as a cooperative, as it was the case of probably the referent in open source development in Spain entity is a cooperative, and is a cooperative that actually they are the ones evangelizing. Does this mean that all the solutions that these cooperatives are doing is open source? Not, but in favor of this part of the movement. Also, I don't know if you are familiar with DISCO, decentralized autonomous organization, or sorry, cooperative organizations. DISCOs, maybe I can put here the link. DISCO, correct me, I think that is like this. DISCO.coop presents an alternative to DAOs, decentralized autonomous organizations, using a cooperative model in that sense. No? And in that sense, still the development in a very early stage, but the idea, for example, similarly to what you were mentioning of a IOTA Foundation, the idea is to create a DISCO Foundation, so then it can be something open up to everyone. Instead of maybe in the case of DAOs, I don't know if you are familiar, one of the main players on DAOs is Aragon, an entity from Zaragoza, and in this case is more proprietary principles of the use of DAOs. I don't know if this helps to your question or not. So I'm happy to see now in the group, I see a few people that we have been meeting personally in Berlin, as Rashid, that you joined the program first edition, and you were giving us an amazing workshop on design thinking for digital platforms and cooperatives last few weeks ago in Berlin.
Yeah, also feel free to share this information, Rashid. I also follow you on the group, on the Telegram group. You are on mute. There is another question. You can talk now.
Did you have a question for me specifically? Sorry, I was sort of packing my bag for the gym and just heard my name and thought I better pop in.
We were promoting you.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, thank you.
I was sharing about the great workshop that you gave us a few weeks ago in Berlin, and then that was great to see you here, Rashid.
Thanks for having you. This is a great space that you're creating.
So Carl is also asking, are there any Telegram groups or Discord servers where people are discussing and collaborating on these projects? Yes, I'm going to share the link to the Telegram and the chat. Yes, one second. Or if you have it, Rashid or Jose Mari, if you have it really close, you can just share it in the chat. There was also another comment from Ian Antonio. Welcome. You wanna talk, or you wanna ask the question yourself, or should I read it?
Well, you can read it if you want.
So the question is, how are the fundamental values of co-ops different, and what systematically safeguard co-ops from tending to evolve into the same? I think you pronounce it. You express it better than me. Sorry.
Oh, okay. Well, I don't know. I'm very new to this. I'm very inspired. I find it quite compelling that at least there are people committed somehow to alternatives. And that alone as a philosophy, I find quite good. However, I suspect that most organizations tend to want to become monopolies. And my question is, what are the safeguards? What is it that fundamentally prevents these organizations from becoming the same as the Ubers and the Googles and the Facebooks? But some of the questions were answered shortly afterwards with philosophy and being in full favor of open source and so on. So that's kind of like a beginner's question, but it's still a concern. So if anybody wants to add, they can go ahead.
Thanks a lot, Ian. I think that, yes, for sure there are some differences that they are very clear on that. No, maybe the first one is that maybe in here I'm going to be maybe not so, how can I say, not so formal, okay? Because in theory, when we talk about digital platform co-ops, does it mean that the legal entity they are using is always a cooperative? In theory, yes. In practice, what we have learned over these last 18 months, there are some cases that it's very difficult to have a legal entity that is a co-op. For example, in the case of Singapore, in order to register a co-op, it might take you, I would say, probably 18 months just to register the co-op. And at the end of the day, what is more important than actually which is the legal entity that you are using is which is the principles that you have in place. No? Before I was sharing with you which are the cooperative principles that they should be in place. Maybe I can share again with you, because any project that is using the digital platform COOPs, they should be embracing the cooperative principles. Okay, so here you have, these are the 10 principles that the Mondragon case we have. They are very similar to the International Cooperative Alliance principles. So first is about free admission. Second, so everyone is open to everyone to really join the movement. Second is democratic organization, one person, one vote. This, for example, is fundamentally totally different than the system of conventional organizations that is based on ownership of the company, not on democratic organization control. Third is sovereignty of work. So is not that we, the sovereignty is of the capital and then the workers are the ones hired by the capital, but it's the reverse. The workers and the create are the creators of the project, the members, and then they use the capital means in order to really run successfully. But in that sense, connecting to the is to the fourth element, capital is an instrument for developing, in this case, the value proposition of the project, what is done. Fifth is an participation in management. So for example, as I mentioned before, in the case of Fermondo, it's not just that I have a digital platform where I have sellers and I have users or customers and I run the platform and I make decisions for them, but actually is if we are collectively creating this, we might have worker members who are the ones creating the digital platform, but then we have also, in this case, seller members who are the ones creating possible that this platform is successful, and they need to be able to participate in decision-making process, in decisions to make, and eventually also users. So people who are participating with as a consumers, and they can also bring their voice, not just consume as customer, but also bring the voice. Similarly, we see in the case of Airbnb. In the case of Airbnb, it's not just a platform where you create a flat and then you just put flats and then you just go or visit or rent these flats. But actually, we could see different type of members in order to make decisions. Most of the digital platform co-ops are multi-stakeholder cooperatives. So in this case, example as Airbnb, there will be the workers who have created the digital platform. Usually this might be more a global platform and they should be co-members to take part. Second is those people who are working to make it happen locally, if it is in Barcelona or it is in Madrid or in Amsterdam or in Venice, they should be working locally in order to make successful the use of the platform. So they are also cooperative members in this case, but a different type of membership. Then we have also the people who put the flats in that platform. In the case of Airbnb, in different than alternate than models like Airbnb. In Airbnb, there is no limit of number of flats per owner. So actually we have a lot of big fans who have 1,000 flats in Valencia. In this case, in Airbnb is limited to, I think it's one or two flats per owner, okay? So this way we use the same model, but it's much more reasonable. A lot of people can put their flat in this platform with their savings, they have a flat, but it's not that I'm just running an alternative to a hotel because I'm a fan, Chinese fan, owning 1,000 flats in Barcelona. This model is not possible under the use of Airbnb. Third type of members is the people who actually use Airbnb for when they are traveling to a city. Instead of being just consumers or customers, they are also members and they could be participating at a certain level in the decision-making, including, for example, in the case of Airbnb, a great part of the economical commission that you can rent or the business model is in favor of social projects in the local community. And there is the people in the local community, including local stakeholders, to make decisions. So then at the end of the day, the use might be similar. Oh yes, you have an alternative to Airbnb and you also have flats, you rent flats, but the participation in management is totally different because everyone is invited to a democratic use of this platform, in the worker members' decision-making, but also in the whole different types of multi-stakeholders type of members, okay? Another ingredient there is the solidarity in retribution or in the payments. In the case of Mondragon, we have 80,000 employees, and the difference in between the ones who have less and the one who have more is 1 to 8, okay? This we can count mainly in Spain. Okay, when we go international, it gets a little bit more complicated. But imagine someone who is working in Eroski, in the Eroski is our retail, like a supermarket. So someone who is a cashier in Eroski is earning 1 probably or a little bit more, 1.6, and then the president of Mondragon is earning 8. Okay, if we convert this to conventional organizations, they might be 1 to 200, 1 to 1,000 in the case of the banks, in the one in between the people who earn the less and who earn the more in the company. So this is also one ingredient that is different. Seventh is intercooperation. Eighth, social transformation. As a cooperative and as a digital platform cooperative, we should aim what we call maybe in our case maybe the three P's of people, planet, and profits, so including profits, but at the same time, or what we say quadruple bottom line. No? You need to maximize the social impact, the economical impact, the environmental impact, and the spiritual impact or the happiness of the people, no? In that sense. 9, universal character. Cooperatives are open to anyone, doesn't matter which is your value. Although, for example, this in the digital platform cooperatives movement, now we are in a struggle. Why? Because we have a lot of local initiatives, and if we try to become an alternative, we need to play together. Otherwise, we'll be always remain residual. So for example, now we are exploring which is the best model to play together. Is it having different digital platforms? Probably not. Maybe it's having a common digital platform common, but then replicating locally and taking care of democratic control of all of them. No? Maybe as the example of CoopCycle, and then more in a federated way. So probably CoopCycle will evolve naturally as a federation of different local teams who are using this model as what running this common platform to serve locally the different reality. And the 10th is education. Sorry, I went a little bit too long, but as you were asking to what might be the principles in the cooperative movement, maybe these are the ones that they are common to the International Cooperative Alliance. And we should explore, not because the legal entity will be a cooperative, but because the living values within those organizations should be embracing the cooperative principles. Does it make any sense?
Absolutely. Thank you very much for that. It was great.
Well, thank you. I am.
Ian, Azoya. Thank you very much.
Azoya. Good. Thank you. Any other questions here? I had a couple of questions, but we already talked about them. Astrid, maybe you want to say something. I saw you on camera, so I thought like you're jumping to say something.
Yeah, because well, I switched it off because somebody was here running around, and I thought, well, yes, I have a question. I mean, I'm based in Berlin. My field of work is leadership development, but I'm a Spaniard, and of course, I know Mondragon, which is the example per excellence about. Success in the cooperative movement. Connecting with the previous question, I would like to ask Jose Mari about, in your experience, in your long experience with the movement, with this initiative, which is really a success, and I hope it will be also in the digital platforms, what are the weaknesses that you have seen in the years that you have testing and really knowing from the practical point? And what would be your, if you had to summarize in one advice to somebody that wants to start to organize an initiative in that model, what would be an advice to be given in order to avoid the weaknesses? Because we have talked about the successes, which are really clear, and they have a lot to do with the values that you mentioned, but what would be the difficulties that in practice you have seen that come maybe from time to time or maybe often?
Thanks a lot, Ashley, and I think it's great that you bring it from this understanding of leadership. Because I think that this might be one of the, or some of the limitations that, you know, many times is linked to leadership, no? in that sense. No? What I would say in the case of Mondragon, you know, that I see two realities. So one is maybe the case of Mondragon as a whole, something created in 70 years ago, who has grown very big, quite successful business-wise. So then it's a different moment, okay, which might be the limitations of Mondragon. The other one is this new digital platform movement is something very new, very vibrant, very starting moment. So also what might be the limitations. So if I start from Mondragon, I will say that as any organization is the structure, okay? So in that sense, Mondragon's success was very local, very connected with existing business, more linked to industry. And eventually Mondragon has been very flexible to constantly adapt somehow and exploring, has not been very, comparing to conventional cooperative movement, has not been very I would say, no, very bureaucratic in the way of decision making, so always very flexible. Actually, the founder of Mondragon, he had a sentence that I think has inspired a lot, that is sharing that Mondragon is a cooperative experience, and as an experience needs to be constantly evolving and changing. For example, this in the 80s, end of 80s, Mondragon realized if they want to remain competitive, they need to open factories abroad, but opening factory in Mexico or in Thailand, come on, it's not a cooperative, why we should be going to Thailand, what should we be doing? And at least with this idea of experience, let's explore how this might be. Trying to bring the values, but let's explore. If we see conventional cooperative movement, we say, okay, no, this is against our values. We cannot have a conventional company open in Mexico, so we should not be doing it. So although Mondragon in that sense has been quite flexible, but in some way the structure and the success of existing model makes some cases too rigid in that sense. No? For example, this local mindset that in the past was very powerful and a reason of success of having the local community a great development and success. In some cases, maybe today we might be running global companies with local mindsets. What is for me is a great challenge. Okay, so for example, one of the things that we, in a humble way, we did from Mondragon Team Academy was the creation of the LEINN program. That is a program for young generation of people from Mondragon and from all around the world. LEINN program is about leadership, entrepreneurship, and innovation. And these might be a few of the elements that we believe that was missing in the Mondragon, not in the existing leaders, but especially the new generations. How do the new generations train themselves and nurture themselves as entrepreneurs, as leaders, and as innovators, and they find a place in the current structure, okay? In our case, it has taken us a few years, you know, has been much easier in some cases to deal with the organizations outside Mondragon than in Mondragon to really see the value of this. I think Jonander also is here. He's a great example because he's a LEINNer himself and now running from Berlin. So I think maybe it would be good if Astrid is in the same location as you, if you meet and you see the new generation of Mondragon, new generation of young players, could be someone as Jonander. And for us, that's a great achievement, no, in that sense, because we believe that this global mindset is very important, this constantly evolving reality. Mondragon, although has been, today we could see that it's more an ecosystem than more one organization, still we need to embrace much more openness in that ecosystem. You know? Actually, I'm one of the defenders of this idea of, okay, we should not be just one planet. We should be maybe more this idea of Saturn. So we have the first ring, the existing system of Mondragon, and then a second ring that represents more organizations. They could not be cooperative for maybe years. They does not mean, today, in order to be part of Mondragon, you need to be a cooperative register in Spain. This in the world of today is very rigid, you know? So maybe we need to have an open ecosystem that an organization from Thailand or from Korea that eventually is a cooperative, or maybe not is a cooperative that embrace fully the principles of cooperatives, they could be part of this ecosystem of Mondragon, no? So for example, this I think is one of the changes. The great things is that, I don't know if you are familiar with the book of the leading thoughts of Aritz Mendiarrieta. I do believe that although the founder of Mondragon, he was someone who lived and who passed away 50 years ago, his leading thoughts were very profound and very futuristic. So in that sense, I think this is a great legacy that we have. In order, when we have a doubt where to go, we can always come back to those values. But today, I think that we have the challenge of disruptive innovation, new creation of companies, exploring new legal entities, exploring funding in a different way. So there are many challenges there. That if we have great leaders, then we are open to experiment and to learn. If we have more managers, then we are fearful to do things different, you know? So in that sense, there may be connecting with your field, I think we have an opportunity and a challenge to overcome. And then regarding the digital platform cooperative movement, the other day I was with one person that for me is one of the most inspiring persons, maybe Estefania, one day we can organize a talk with him. He's Antonio Cancelo. He was the founder of Eroski. And then later on, he was the second president of Mondragon. He's already 86 years old, but he's very bright and he's very fresh and always very disruptive. And for example, we were discussing, no, about this digital platform cooperative movement. He's someone who has been supporting the cooperative movement for many years. He was totally in favor of what this means in terms of revolution, in terms of scale, and the globalization of the cooperative movement, and in terms of digitalization of the cooperative movement. But then he was coming back to me and telling me, but please do it with business excellency. You know, it cannot be that because we are we have different values, we are much more profound, we are in favor of humanity, then we became a residual alternative to existing solutions. You know, so what I will say is that for this digital platform cooperative movement, what we need to say is that we need to be able to compete in value created with existing massive monopoly solutions, you know, and this is easy to say and very difficult to do. No? For example, in the case of Airbnb, we are now registered in Airbnb for Iberia, Spain, and Portugal as a second degree cooperative. And for example, we say, come on, Airbnb has 350 flats in Spain, okay? Airbnb cannot start with these big numbers, but then we need to have remarkable experiences for those users who put their flats there, for the local communities, for the people who use the platform, in order that annually we are achieving a market share comparing. Maybe first year is 5%, then it's 10%, then it's, but then we need to really become an alternative. So what cannot be is that in 10 years from now, we still represent a 2% of the in this case, the tourism platform. So I think there is where we have a challenge. And for doing that, we need to intercooperate very strongly. We need to have a strong digital technology backbone. We need to have a strong funding backbone, because you need to have funds in order to make it happen. And then also a legal and lobby, so legal coverage legally, and also lobby locally, playing with the local town halls. Because in most of the countries, all the regulation that has been done in the digital, for digital platforms, has been to control and to somehow to fight digital platforms. I would love to see regulations to propose the use of human-centered digital platforms that maybe as platform cooperatives might represent. No? But this requests a lot of lobby in order to convince the local autonomies about this. I don't know if this might give an answer or not. I see Sarah, I'm ready to ask something.
Thank you very much. And thank you, Estefania, for organizing this. Good to see you again. I'm here. I managed to make it with some trouble I had. But thank you, Jose Mari. I think I'm learning a lot, actually. Instead of shedding light, I'm going to pose even more, I think, questions I have about my personal. Of course, I'm investigating actually this fourth sector, which we're doing ourselves, and definitely a transition from triple bottom line to this quadruple. I was happy to hear where the idea of purpose or the spiritual or more profound understanding of the connections between things becomes more the kind of central principle that drives the triple balance. No? But in terms of cooperatives, I've been studying a little bit of steward ownership. So my question is really twofold. One is, with steward ownership, I see more agility. Is a bit low? Yeah. I see with steward ownership, more agility in terms of probably the main barrier, I think, is probably this one person, one vote, where, you know, in more agile companies, maybe you need to have people coming in and leaving and having some kind of a governance kind of structure. Well, of course, the ownership and governance is separated, so that provides this flexibility and to not have this profit maximization built into the operating system. So they separate ownership and governance, but they don't have this strict requirement for one person, one vote, in fact. So that was one question, is how do you see the difference between steward ownership and shared wealth organizations as part of the fourth sector, and also the co-ops? And the second question to that is the funding. Exactly, you said funding is required to be able to really do this. So the challenge I see is that if the funding is to compete on the same level with the normal capital markets, the current organizations are high profit. They look for the current funds or seeking the highest rate of return, and they don't care that much at the moment with the externalities. So in your case, how do you attract funds sufficiently to really expand, you know, in this fourth sector, because it's a major problem. So you mentioned two things. So I would love to hear about that from your experience.
Thanks a lot, Saddam. No? Regarding if I understood you well, because in the beginning I didn't hear you very well. If I understand you well, the first point that you have been doing research on the fourth sector, right? As an alternative.
Yeah, which I call it actually Enterprise 4.0, more the Economy 4.0, which is the kind of, yeah, the future network platform economy that you're mentioning.
Yeah. Yeah, so in that sense, what I think is great is that the way management is moving forward and business models is a lot into platforms and is a lot into, I would say, team-based organizations where everyone is more like entrepreneurial. I don't know if you are familiar with the model of Hire. I think it's a great example of business model, business management practice today. You know, Hire is a huge organization. We had the opportunity to, I had the opportunity to really learn from them when I was living in China since many years ago. If you see the reality of the management of Hire in the 90s, in the late 90s, and today, you cannot believe it's the same organization. So today is a whole organization based on teams, autonomous teams that they run as small companies, and they play in a network system with internal platforms as well with stakeholders as external platforms. No? Actually, the team from Italy who created this platform design toolkit that maybe we can
boundaryless. They were showing that Amazon actually copied those guys, didn't they?
So in that sense, I think that the what is great is that this the way management is evolving is totally in favor to a system more based on a cooperation system and where people become creators and they keep become creators in teams. From my personal opinion, when people talk about cooperative and cooperative entrepreneurship, for me it's team entrepreneurship. So that's what makes difference. So when two or more people come together to do something, they do not want to do it, they cannot do it alone, or they don't want to do it alone. Okay. And this way, starting from teams of two, three people, creating things together, cooperating, then eventually you can create a network of team of teams that can go massively, as we can see in Hire, but we can go anywhere. So in that sense, this small is beautiful. Small teams playing together with other teams, if we create a culture of team of teams playing together, then you can become very big, you know? So it's not about when we talk, no? Okay, how is it's about ants individually. It's not ants, it's a small cells of teams who play together and maybe in more organic way. This, in theory, the cooperative principles should be ahead. In practice, I would say no. In practice, the cooperative structure, including Mondragon, and then seeing other cooperative structures around the world, they are very bureaucratic, has been created more based on this legal entity. Around the world, I think is one third or one fifth of all the workers around the world, they are cooperatives, you know? So they should be a real alternative in terms of size. But the reality is we have a lot of cooperatives that they just have a cooperative entity, but then the management is not participation. It's totally different, you know, in that sense. No? So combining both, I would say cooperative model has a great potential of becoming an alternative in the next years. But although they have deeper values connecting to what the world needs, the reality is today cooperative structure, it might be in some cases far behind of conventional organizations, okay? So then it's, oh yes, you might be in a better condition in order to play, but at the same time, you might have a bigger challenge because the movement has been developed in a too much structured way, you know? There is clearly some countries as Venezuela or China or those communist countries in Russia, or like in Russia and the regions who were in the woods behind, that is all these countries, they are totally against cooperatives, but probably it's not because the cooperative itself, they are totally against because they have lived a cooperative understanding that was a totally political strategy and nothing to do with the potential of a cooperative. No? So said this, I would say cooperative principles and team entrepreneurship is totally the new way of management that might be evolving. Then the cooperative movement has an opportunity to adapt to that, but at the same time has a challenge because they might not be in the best condition to do it, you know. Mm-hmm. The opportunity, what it is, that in the digital platform cooperatives, digitally wise, there are very few cooperatives until now. So then as a new movement inside the cooperative movement, if we do the things right, maybe we can bring an upgrade version of the use of the cooperative values. Maybe these are some ideas. I think I don't have an answer, but at least a few thoughts to share to your first question.
Sorry, can I just, I mean, on this first point, I think, can I add something or just
please,
wondering?
Please.
I was wondering maybe the this rigidity, as you say, like if you define cooperatives in a more looser sense of this cooperation and this kind of decentralized small units working together, then for me that, as what I'm exploring, it makes more sense like going forward, because this rigid one person, one vote, for example, that's been defined by the International Cooperative Organization, for example, that seems to be certain levels of, you know, a stricted understanding or a very specific understanding of what is the cooperative. Because from what you're telling me, you know, cooperative could potentially be more aligned to this kind of anarchic voluntary association type models, you know, which I completely think is finally we're in a position where we could probably go in that direction because of, you know, the technology and platforms allowing this kind of coordination, as you were saying. So maybe the definition of what's a cooperative is a question whether, you know, it is what it's been defined or it can be more loosely interpreted, as long as it's not basically promoting this kind of monolithic monopoly type organization. You know, if you can incentivize decentralization, regardless of having this one person, one vote. So these are the questions I wonder.
Yeah, for me, I'm fully, so I think the democratic control is, I'm totally in favor. So in terms of democratic participation, but then what I'm totally, wouldn't say against, no? But I think the cooperative movement cannot be defined by the use of a cooperative legal entity. If we are talking about the Basque region and Spain, I would say totally yes. Why? Because we have a totally in favor, solid legal backbone that eventually you can create a company, equally a cooperative and a non-cooperative legal entity, liability company. But if you go to whatever other place, in most of the cases, it's much more complicated to create a cooperative. It's almost impossible. You have a lot of political lobby behind. So then at the end of the day, it's come on. I want to apply the cooperative principles. I don't want to be defined by the structure. No?
For me, it's a metaphor,
no? I use a metaphor that is the one of, am I a polite person or am I dressed in a nice suit? You know, if I'm a polite person and I'm dressed in a nice suit, it fits perfect. But if I'm a very rude person and then I'm trying to wear a suit, okay, it's even worse. No, better be dressed what you feel comfortable, not by using a suit you will be. And if I'm a polite person and suddenly I'm dressing like a Gandhi in India, okay, I will still be very respectful, you know. So I think that the legal entity should be more the suit that you put and the way you behave. So it's a software and hardware reality. It's not that the cooperative is defined by the hardware.
So sorry, the direct question maybe is, would you say that it's possible to have a cooperative without one person, one vote? I mean, that's actually what the question is. Because if you forget that legal entity, if you have a cooperative based on a voluntary association of some internal agreement between people, could it be still a cooperative in your view if it's not one person, one vote?
For me, the democratic control, I think, is a fundamental.
Does it have to be one person, one vote, or it could be representative of, you know, having the views of everybody listened to, but then having some kind of a governance?
Yeah, maybe I can share with you what we have learned. No? The way we are creating this new young generation of team entrepreneurs is actually all the decisions that the teams are making. Today we have around 2,500 team entrepreneurs in 13 MTA labs around the world. And they use the principle of decision-making power based on we even go further, you know, in small teams of 15 people, in order to experiment democratic control and participation, they go into a model of more the African democracy system. That means unanimous decisions. Does it mean unanimous decision that everyone is in favor of one decision? No, probably imagine that we are, now we are 15 people here and 12 people are thinking one way, I think different. At the end, seeing the whole collectively, I agree that's the best decision for the team. Maybe I have a different opinion, but I agree. So I'm 100% on this decision. No? So in our case, we go even more strict in the way of democratic participation with our teams in the LEINN program. I put you there, the one that we are running in Berlin, LEINN Arts, and maybe OpenLEINN is the global platform for the movement. In that sense, I would say that experimenting democratic and participation is a key fundamental in that sense. Does this mean that, let's imagine one of these digital platform COPs, that I will, maybe to your second question regarding funding. Does this mean that the funders cannot be part of the, in this case, of the digital platform? I think yes. I will personally, I will give them power to almost 50% of the entity, but never, in the case of the, in Spain, the Sociedades Anónimas Laborales, that is the labor limited associate or companies, liability companies, employees liability companies. In this case, it's a 60% should be the in this case, the workers, no? I would say I'm very happy to open up to funds to invest in cooperatives and to give them, hopefully, is more long-term impact fund type of funders. So it's not others who are looking short-term, I would say like more just aiming for the return on investment immediately and profits as soon as possible approach. But now that we are seeing a great development of impact investment, I think it would be great to open up the cooperative model for them, but always not making that the fund, that the funds will make the decision for the whole organization. So remaining the democratic control, but for sure bringing the voice. And in this case, if a group of funders are representing 40% of the cooperative, they should be bringing their voice, you know? And doesn't mean that they need to be the same number of people of these 40, it could be less, but they should be bringing their voice totally, you know? For example, in our university, we are a university, we have three types of members, the workers, all the staff, professors, staff of the university, then the students, and then local companies. In our board of directors, who makes the board of the organization who make the decision, we have a general assembly annually, but the board of directors is formed by 9 members. 3 of them represent all the staff, all the workers. 3 of them represent all the students. So imagine we have 3,000 students and we might have, I don't know, 400 workers. So it's not one person, one vote, but you have different types in the decision-making, what is that? And 3 of them represent the local companies. In our case, even as a university, the president is always a local company. Why? Because we want to be a university very connected with the business reality and what does the society needs, you know? We don't want to get too much academical, too much academic, too much looking to yourself, self-referent, teacher-oriented. So the way to do that is in the board, students, staff, and companies are represented, and the president is always from the business side in that sense to actually assure that the university is supporting the development of the local community there. For example, these sort of movements is the ones that I think we need to explore. You know, in these digital platform COPs, I would love to imagine, as I mentioned in the case of Airbnb, I would love to imagine that, okay, the ones who have created the platform, they will have their own running as a startup globally, very solid, best-in-class team. The ones who are running locally, as I mentioned, the case of Spain, in between Catalonia, Madrid, and the different regions, that we could be running into a second degree cooperative and making the decision strategically of what we're doing, that we are inviting, as Felix is doing with Fermondo, all the people who are putting the flats. It's not that I put my flat, I'm invited to give my opinion about what should be the direction of the platform going. And even if I'm a user, in terms of using the flats, also I'm invited to give my opinion. Will that mean that the decision of someone who puts a flat is the similar decision of someone who is devoting his or her life for 15 years developing the digital platform? Not. So it's not this one person, one vote. But in the different type of members, everyone is experimenting participation and democratic control. Okay. I don't know if this might be some of the ideas. It's not a concrete answer, but maybe the way we should, I think we should be moving on. Does it make any sense, Saram, or not?
I was on the thing. Yeah, I was on silent. Yeah, I think it's helping a lot to see that there is some flexibility. And I mean, also Rashid was mentioning the sociocracy model. And I think that moving to some more agile ways of democratically controlling, because I mean, even in our modern democracies, we see that democracy is not always the best answer to solving societal challenges. I mean, that's my personal view. Because, you know, 50% can vote one way or another and, you know, not necessarily represent, you know, I mean, that's another debate, but I think that the, you know, this kind of representative model of governance that you mentioned about the board definitely is a way of participating, but not directly maybe. So this direct democracy maybe is a question on bureaucracy and slowing things down. But I think you really helped me.
And then maybe one last thing regarding participation is, when we talk about participation, we talk about participation on information. We talk about participation in decision-making. We talk about participation in ownership, and we talk participation in what to do, ownership of the profit and losses, and what to do, okay? So also when we talk about many times is, what does it mean participation? There are many different angles, you know? And we need to take care of all of them and experimenting all of them, you know? Because actually when we open up to participation, what we have learned, people always is in favor of participation. But then if you say, okay, but then we participate in profits, that's great. We participate in losses. Okay, sorry, I'm not interested, you know? I want my salary fixed in any condition. Okay, then how we can move into sharing profit and loss if we are not happy to do that, you know? So I think as a humanity, we need to explore what does, and we need to learn what does it mean to participate, no? What we try to do in MTA is, for example, enabling youth to experiment for 4 years. What does it mean participation in everything? And they make their decision participation. Then eventually, when you have been trained in a cooperative way based on teams, then you become much more wise. When you say participation, what does it mean? Which are the consequences? What to do, how not to do, no? In that sense. So as humans, we need to learn with time, you know?
But I think that's entrepreneurship. You know, if we move out of the slave salary mentality that you know, comes from a colonial kind of past or historical heritage, no? That the idea of salary, jobs, human beings are entrepreneurs, you know? So we need to take risks.
I think, Estefania, there's one sentence. The other day we were having a talk now it's not coming the name, from the classic, I will come later. I think you were there, Estefania, in the talk that we have with now it's not coming the name. This classic guy who is a full supporter of cooperative movement. I think Rashid, you were also probably there in the call. From the US,
he used Chomsky.
So I have a small video of the dialogue we have with Chomsky that was outstanding, although he's 90 something years old. And something he was sharing that maybe is connected to what you say, Saran. He said that in order to have like a new understanding of where humanity we could go, we should all feel invited to be artisan artists, you know? We should be connecting again, not with this, okay, I work for someone, someone decides for me, so more to feel free artisans, creators of our future, you know? I think on that, I'm lucky to be part of ASHOKA Social Entrepreneurs Network. And for example, this principle that everyone a change maker, I think this should be a right for humanity, no?
Yeah.
All of us, we should have the identity of being able to be a change maker. It doesn't matter if it's with small actions or with great things, but experimenting change making in our lives, not that someone decides for us, we are passive, human beings that this someone decides what we need to be doing and we just execute, you know. If we don't embrace this capacity of becoming a change maker or an artist, an artistic free artist, as Chomsky was saying, probably machines are going to do things much better than us. And then we will not have, many times now when the people talk about machines and they say, okay, how fearful are you that machines will be able to do things as humans? What I usually say is that I'm more fearful about that humans, we do things as machines, you know, that we lose to do, keep on doing things that make us really human, you know?
Absolutely.
That's where I think we have the challenge.
That's true.
Thank you very much.
By the way, do you have that video maybe from our?
Yeah, I think I'll look for somewhere. I can share with you and then you can put it in the, I will find it and send to you later.
Because I'm doing a recap of every event and then I share the specific links. So I will share some case studies and so on. So also for the people who were not able to join today to the event, they can, you know, see this recording. By the way, it's not going to be on YouTube or anything like this. I just uploaded to a drive and it's a private recording. And then also some links related to the topic. So okay. More questions or more insights?
From my side, I'm very happy for this session. And at the same time, I feel very sorry because I'm enjoying a lot, but I need to run, you know, because talking about humans, I have my two kids waiting for me to pick them up. And if I don't go, no one will go, okay? So I can join from the car if there's people willing to keep on continuing, but I will need a few minutes, or if not, we can finish here. How do you see, Estefania?
I'm wondering if you don't have a robot babysitter. No, I'm kidding. So it's up to the group. If you want to keep talking, we have the Telegram group, and otherwise I would say we can still talk in the LinkedIn event. And of course this topic is huge, that's why it's the second time we talk about this topic in the meetup. And I'm a big fan also of this kind of alternatives and alternatives to this gig and sharing economy. So if everyone's fine, then I would say we can talk on other channels and we can just say goodbye for today. And thank you again for coming, everyone. And thank you, Jose Mari, for like a very insightful talk.
Thank you all.
Very inspiring. Oh,
this is a SIG meeting, okay? So now we have the opportunity and responsibility to put water and sun and love to see what we can be developing together from here. For anything, I think to Estefania, you have my contact. Here I am at your service.
And also Sharam had...
With you. Thank you.
I thought you were in contact because Sharan had a project also that is kind of related, so you can really talk directly, I think. Yeah,
very much. I'm in contact with Mondragon for the university program they're running, so I wonder if you know them, and I would love to contact you with them regarding that. Thanks for your insights. And
thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you everyone. Enjoy the terraces wherever you are. It's so hot here. I was like, thank you, everyone. So, see you soon.